So how are we a part of that kingdom? Most of you know that answer. Maybe not all of you do. How are we a part of it? Spiritual and physical attendance into the kingdom of God is first of all attained by what? Receiving Christ. Right? So we're to be born of water and spirit. John 3:4-6 says, how can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked, surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. Frankly, nobody would want to enter in a second time. See, that's my mind. We're too big. We can't go back into the womb and be reborn, can we? Okay? Jesus said, I tell you the truth. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. What's that mean? That's not water of baptism. That's water of the mother's water breaking before she delivers that baby. So we have to be born physically first. And then after we're born physically, then we need to receive Christ spiritually. How do we do that? What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? I was reading the material yesterday and today. It is amazing amongst Christians, the body of Christ, the diversity of answers of what the gospel is. I mean, you'd think it'd be simple, completely understood, and grabbed onto by every Christian, because we're all saved. But there were some pretty elaborate statements about what the gospel was that did not even include the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Isn't that a shame? And we know that the gospel is what? God sent his Son, right? Died across our sins. He was buried in the grave. He's alive today in heaven. He rose from the grave on the third day. He's alive today in heaven. And if we ask God to forgive us of our sins and come into our life, he will. That's the gospel. But we can live eternally with him. But some people think that that in itself is all that we need. If I'm secured, if I'm saved, if I know I'm going to that place of that future promise of heaven and how the scripture points it out, that's all I'm concerned about. Now, we were talking also a little while ago today about the parallel of our growth as human beings and that of our spiritual growth. Where, you know, a child is born, it's a babe, it needs attention, and all that stuff. It's a child, it has childish things, right? It becomes a youth. What happens to youth when they become youth? I become the center of the world, right? Everything about I. Normal. Sorry. But it's about I. You know, that's just the normal thing about youth. And then after that, then we grow up into adults and we start parenting as well. Okay, so there's some cycles about our life that parallel our spiritual life. But Paul had talked to the Corinthians, I believe it was the Corinthians, one of the epistles that he wrote, that you're still desiring milk like a babe. You're content with the fundamentals of the scripture, the basic truths of Christianity, and that's all that you want to hear, but you don't want to grow from there. So all of us need to have that spiritual growth in our life. And so we're born physically, and we're born spiritually, and then we're expected to grow spiritually to mature God to help others become mature in Christ as well. Because they didn't finish that verse in John 3:4-6, it says, Jesus answered, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he's born of water and spirit. The flesh gives birth to flesh, but the spirit gives birth to spirit. Is that all God wants from us, that we're just spiritually alive to him? Of course not. He wants us to grow in him continuously. We're also sealed with the spirit. You know, there's the promise that when we know the Holy Spirit that lives in our heart and we recognize the presence of the Lord, what is that? That in essence is a guarantee from God to you and to me that I am real, that I am alive, that I am in your life, and you belong to me, to God. And that God will fulfill his promises. Ephesians 1:13-14 says, and you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. So it's a guarantee that God will follow through on his promise to us. But I think it's real important for us to love the Lord. You know, where'd that come from all of a sudden, Pastor? Well, look what he's done for us. And look at the promise and the hope we have, and the security that we have, even in death, that we have life in Christ, eternal. And in that, God has called us to be his people. The church needs to be a clear distinction of God's people. Church needs to be that, you know, you've heard the parallel, be a lighthouse in your community. And we know that the beacon that draws people to Christ. Well, instead of thinking about what do you call those things? The beacon, the
lighthouse.
Thank you. I saw it, I just couldn't get the word. Instead of being a beacon that says caution and the ships and coming this way and be drawn here, we often think about that parallel about the church, right? The church is the light that draws people into the church. Thank you for that. Okay, yeah, we are getting back there. Good. All right, so instead of looking at it that way, we need to be looking at it from the other view, that the light from the beacon goes out. And that the light cuts through the darkness like a knife. And it is clear, it is distinctive, and it is not murky. But how can we be that type of people? Because that's what God wants us to be. And as we yield our lives to Christ and follow him and love him and truly walk with him and fall deeper in love with Jesus, we will be much more that light. And we'll be that salt.